He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice in the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D. Tony D'Angelo.
All right, Tony joins us every Tuesday here to broadcast as we are today across the entire state on the Connecticut Radio Full Power Network, which is always a pleasure to get a chance to be joined by our friends up in and around Hartford. Now, you can find out more about Tony at Tony D'Angelo 7 on the X or the Twitter. He's also got a great YouTube page, and you actually shot a YouTube video yesterday. Tell everybody about that.
Well, yeah, first of all, good morning, everybody. I'm proud to be among you in all the places where we normally aren't. Yeah, we have a little video show. It's called 30 with Tony, and we did a actually turned out to be a little bit longer. We did a Christmas show yesterday that I was really surprised at how many people were watching it. I figure people have things to do on Christmas. Now, my wife, Kathy, said, you know, there's a lot of people that are just home, nothing to do, you know, would appreciate a little human contact as much as you could give them over a phone or a computer screen. And we had a rollicking good time. It was a lot of fun. It really, you know, gave me a little bit of a different perspective than I may have.
And where do they find that? Where do they go?
You can find that. You can find that on my Twitter feed. You can also find that on YouTube. You go to 30 with Tony, and then you click on my channel, and then you'll find the most recent shows.
Sounds good. All right, you want to go back to the EV car world today?
People are going to say I'm driving around in circles, but, you know, we have a lot of new kids today, and just wanted to do a little refresher here with what's been happening. We've been covering, you know, on Lee's show, the, you know, what I've been calling the EV debacle and the mandatory 2035 can't sell gas vehicles and. Now, one of the statements I had made, which people kind of looked at me and rolled their eyes and said, that's not possible, is that, you know, we're getting into a situation because of the fact that the minerals can't be mined. The mineral process of mining is incredibly cruel. It's almost like a genocide of people. Actually, it is a genocide of people of color. The manufacturers are losing their shirts. And pretty much, you know, the straight-on forge-ahead, whatever you want to call it, state media, bureaucrat, political mentality. Oh, no, you know, that's hogwash. Well, the hogs started to wash themselves last week. This happened a lot sooner, Lee Elci, than, you know, I could have imagined. The dealers, basically, this would be Ford and this would be GM, particularly Buick, got into a situation where, you know, it's like any other kind of a business contract. You cruise along and then after, at a point certain, you got to come up with a whole bunch of money to go forward. Now, Ford has 1,550 dealers, according to an article I was reading, Detroit Free Press, and roughly half of them said, we ain't taking this stuff anymore. We ain't taking this product. You know, you can call it whatever you want. But basically, what they're saying is that, you know, we're not going to take these things wholesale, and we can't get for them retail what you guys are charging us for. So guess what, guys? We ain't going to sell them. You put us in a precarious position with these things. And, you know, it's and basically Ford dealers had to come up. This is a lot of money, anywhere between $500,000 and $1.2 million to actually get to the next level of infrastructure for charging. And half of them said, "Look, you know, we ain't going to do it." Now GM probably is in worse shape. The Buick dealers are like, you know, their buy-in was like $300,000 to $400,000. They're like, we can't sell these things, you know. So GM corporate, probably one of the most mismanaged entities going back forever and ever on earth, you know, they said, well, you know, okay, we're going to buy Buick from you. You can continue to sell your trucks and your GMCs and that kind of thing. So what you've got happening now, a whole lot sooner than I had anticipated, is that if you're going to go to E-Car 2035 and the air is clean and we're going to have these poor people mining minerals and, you ain't going to have no freaking product, you numbskulls. Don't you get it? And I mean, and this is where I made the statement last week, and not everybody listens to us, that we have new people today. Thank you. But basically, I said, if you're in the legislature, and if you're in DEEP, and you're saying in the least way this is something that is good, you're not only economically illiterate, but you're putting the state in a situation where there may not be vehicle transportation as the gas-powered cars get older, and then, you know, if the e-cars are not manufactured. I mean, this happened a whole lot more quickly than I would have anticipated. You're bald, my friend.
So what is the plan, Tony? What do you see as the diabolical reason behind Buick buying, you know, obviously buying these dealerships? But, I mean, is it just to limit the amount of actual gas powered cars we're going to have?
I think in Buick's case, it was, you know, bad management. It was in self-preservation. They really, when Biden ran in 2020 and all the dealers got behind him because they saw the Green New Deal and they thought this is going to be a wonderful thing. And, you know, Donald Trump, of course, is, you know, drill, baby, drill, very fossil fuel. And, you know, nothing in that really new for them. So they just saw green new horizons. Now I think they're just trying to throw water out of the boat personally.
So where does that leave the consumer 10 years from now?
Well, that's my point. That's exactly my point. I mean, it's when, you know, no one is burning up the barn on these things. Nobody, you know, and it's like you say to yourself, now we've mentioned the Saudi Public Investment Fund ties to the family of King Governor Ned Lamont the Unaccountable. They're throwing everything into this thing. They're building charging stations and all that other kind of stuff. But the biggest force on any of this, you know, and this is the thing, this is a dirty word in Connecticut, market forces. Market forces will determine what happens. Connecticut thinks, oh, no, it's programs and politics. No, none of that. It's market forces. Money is a very powerful force, like fire, like water, not good, not evil. And the market is determining, you know, wherever that, you know, now the dealers don't want to push the stuff. So I think this whole, whatever you want to call it, collapse is going to happen a whole lot more quickly than anticipated.
Well, so then there's no winner in this.
None. None.
Right?
None. Like, it is a total and complete bureaucratic and corporate disaster complicated by the idiocy of politics. You got that right, man.
Yeah, so like the consumers lose, the businesses lose, the government lose, no tax rate, everybody loses.
It's insane.
Wow. I mean, all right, so these EV mandates, as you know, I know that they were able to sort of brush them off and not, you know, the legislature that didn't necessarily in the last go around make it a mandate. The governor backed off, but you think this is going to be picked up again next session, right?
Oh, I think so. And I mean, I think the only way to combat it is if you see somebody in government and, you know, to say, "Do you understand?" And very polite terms, the economics of what you're doing and how this world that you're proposing is going to be a world that's going to be so wonderful. And, you know, there's no cars here. And, oh, yeah, what do you do about a power outage or something like that with our incredibly reliable electric company? You know, and just, you know, I mean, this is really where the adults have to enter the room. And here the adults are really going to be the good people of Connecticut. It's certainly not the system.
Tony D'Angelo is with us every Tuesday. You can find out more about him on the X, Tony D'Angelo 7. By the way, I am taking a rare day off next week. Tony D'Angelo will be filling in for me on Tuesday. How about that? So, and you've got it all split up where half the show is guests, half the show is callers, right?
That's right. You know, because we've got the best callers in the universe. And I've, you know, I've bent your ear about that, you know, ad nauseum. And we're going to have 2 hours, you know, rock and roll, let it all hang out. I mean, we had one of our callers last night sending us information. And this guy's ready to get out of the box, so we're going to let him run and see what happens. We're going to have some fun.
You talking about Reed?
Yes.
Yeah, Reed sent me something that's above my... Reed sent me something that's like a mathematical equation. That chart is hard. Jesus, goodness gracious. There's a lot of information there. All right, so let's move to the Corporate Transparency Act.
Oh, yeah, this is really good. I'll try to do my best here in 9 minutes or so. We touched on last week how aggravatedly upset, I know that's not a word, I was on the re-up of Section 702 of the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. You know, you get Christopher Wray, the FBI director, and Ted Cruz rails at him and says all kinds of horrible things to him, you know, albeit deservedly, for what the FBI is doing. And using FISA to spy on, you know, Catholic school mothers and things like that, and Latin mass people, and on and on and on. But, you know, when it came down to it, there was only 13 senators that voted against it, and one of the people voting for it was Senator Cruz. So, you know, you just kind of draw your own conclusions with that. But we got another one coming out, and this is going to be real in 2024. And it's, you don't hear a lot about it, and it's called the, it's coming right at small business. It's called the Corporate Transparency Act. Now, a little bit of background. You know, when people hear the word bipartisan, they get nervous. This is a bipartisan effort, and I'm not against bipartisanship, but this was passed in 2021, part of the National Defense Authorization Act. It is administered by FinCEN, F-I-N-C-E-N. It is not administered by the IRS, and basically, it's an old-style Jerusalem-type tax. If you own, you have to check the specifics of this. Check it with your advisors. You have to go to the FinCEN site. Small corporations, limited liability corporations, limited liability partnerships, small businesses. Businesses less than 20 employees have to report their, what's called their beneficial owners. In other words, who owns all these LLCs and, you know, in, throughout the country. And there's some exceptions to it. There's 23 of them. You could read who they are, you know, or send me a message if you have any question about that. Now, this is something you have to do. You must do, because FinCEN makes the IRS look like little orphan Annie. These guys don't play around. If you don't get the report there on that day, the fines are $500 a day, and if it's determined to be willful, people can go to jail. Don't screw around with this. You have to do it. It personally makes me sick. And if you haven't been advised by your people that this is something you have to do, well, you know, maybe it's time for a little bit of melon knocking there. But this, one of the big champions of this, we have people from Rhode Island, Sheldon Whitehouse, and he's sort of in on a tackle with Marco Rubio, Elizabeth Warren, Ron Wyden, and as far as they're concerned, this whole path into small business, as far as who the owners are, is not going far enough, and that we need to have more disclosures. And you read the, you know, the actual final rule. There was a final rule that was passed on December 21st, supposedly giving clarity. Well, giving clarity is for somebody like me. You're giving me 87 pages of small print to read. But basically, what they want to do is find out who owns all of these businesses, and, you know, who, you know, because the whole thing is, when you come down to, you know, what they're really saying, it's designed, you know, the typical political thing against criminals and foreign enemies. I'm reading from the White House press release, hiding assets from law enforcement, and. Now, the thing that's scary to me is that, yeah, it's another government agency for which you've got to account for, you know, a guy doing electricity or roofing or, you know, trying to keep it. It's like, all right, this is something else I need to do. This is something else. This is another peak of my government into me. You know, we've gone from the warrantless wiretaps, the Section 702, to now, you know, you've got to find out who owns my LLC. Well, it's me and my wife. And, you know, it's like, and Lee Elci, I say to myself, well, why are people 25, you know, whatever it is, 20 employees and under, the only people that have to report? It's like, what about, you know, banks don't have to report, $5 million or more in revenue doesn't have to report. So it's this whole thing of, you know, I see this as, yeah, I'm all for going after the bad guy. That's not, but they don't like to go after, you know, the bad guy. And it's kind of this whole thing of the surveillance state. I was saying back in 2001, 2002, be careful what kind of, you know, latitude you give these people. You know, be careful what you're saying it's okay to do to, quote unquote, keep it safe, because it's like a tax or a toll. It's just going to keep getting bigger. It's just going to keep getting larger. And where I particularly have concerns about this, you have a year to do it, as well as I'm understanding it, is that when you have a state like Connecticut, and we talked this past summer about the Elder Banking Act, and you know how it passed unanimously, and basically in Connecticut, you know, an 18-year-old bank clerk with reason to believe that that guy Lee Elci is going to do something terrible with his father's money can freeze the assets. And, you know, it's like, well, what else does, oh, well, you know, he's got an LLC, you know, and, well, gee, maybe we have to do something with that, you know, and it's that kind of a thing. Now, there's some safeguards here in the fact that these penalties go all the way around. So local law enforcement who must have a court order to do this, if they misuse it, they're subject to the same penalties. But basically, it's like, how do you really know? Who do you really trust? And you have to ask yourself, why? Why does this happen? Now, of course, the obvious thing, which didn't hit me until this morning, after all, it's me, is go back to 2020 and where I was screaming at when Joe Biden released his tax returns. And I think I was on the air the next day, and I was screaming about the fact that, you know, I was trying to get to Ronna McDaniel saying, this guy is using an LLC to launder money offshore. Jim Comer is getting to that now, years later. I saw that then. I'm not brilliant. It was obvious. If they're really serious, if they're as serious as they are about Section 702A, if Jim Comer is really serious about, you know, I want to get to the Biden shell companies and that sort of thing, and he does not start saying corporate transparency, the guy's full of hot air. I'm sorry, because if you're going to start going after Chuck in a truck, you know, what about the Biden shell companies, which really fit right into the definition of what they want to look at? Excuse me, what about the Lamont family shell companies in Delaware, right? Anybody paying any attention to that? Well, you know the answer to that. So basically, I mean, this is a requirement. It's going to happen. You're hearing very little about it. It's FinCEN. Don't screw around with it. But you have to ask yourself, really, when you look at your political parties, and it's like, we're here to protect you, we're here to serve you, why does it always seem to back up on the little guy to do everything, and somehow this other stuff just continually happens? I don't know. I'm just not that bright.
Tony D'Angelo, follow him on the Twitter, TonyD'Angelo7. And Tony, you got any other guests that people may want to know about so they can make sure they tune in next Tuesday?
Well, actually, the biggest guest right now is me. We can do interviews. I'm going to think about, because I do have the capability to do that. But I want to make this brief. I want to make it hit something. What I like about it is that we can throw a document up. We could read it together. I want to engender an interest. I just don't want to bore the hell out of people, basically. So this is my this is my way of doing it. And listen, I'm always open to suggestions. Somebody actually was yelling at me because the program I'm using, when I go to a document, my head gets very, very small, and it's like, I want to see your face. It's like, well, I'm trying to get my I don't know how to program that thing right now, but you know, I mean, it's what we're going over in substance, I think, is a lot more important than my ugly mug.
Well, you can follow Tony on the YouTube page as well. Tony, thank you, pal.
Thank you, pal. Thanks,
Have a good one.